Hello, beloved of the Lord. This is Bev Potter. This is a subject that the Lord has put on my heart, and I tried to do a video on Friday, but I wasn't able to. I just came under so much. Just oppression, brain fog, extreme fatigue, and as a dear sister described it, discombobulation. So, but yesterday I felt that there was an open door to, plan this video and share what I believe the Lord has shown me. So it is Sunday, December 2nd, 2018, and I would like to share with you what the Lord has shown me about the power, place, and purpose of a woman. So first I'd like to talk a little bit about Eve and what took place in the garden. So on Friday, 2 days ago, I felt the Lord telling me that Eve left her first estate. And that brought me to Jude 1:6, where we read, "And the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day." Now, we are not under the judgment, same judgment as the angels, because the angels did what they did knowingly. And so when they came down to cohabit with women, they knew that what they were doing was wrong and there would be a judgment for that. Now, Eve was deceived, and so women are not under that same type of judgment, but I noticed that the Lord used the same wording. They left their first estate. So what does that mean? What's an estate? Okay. And I believe he's talking about Eve's divinely assigned place of ministry. All right, let's just take a minute and look at the word estate. So here's a definition. From Merriam-Webster. All right, so first definition is a state or condition. Second is social standing or rank, especially of a high order. Number three, a social or political class, specifically one of the great classes, such as the nobility, the clergy, and the commons, formerly vested with distinct political powers. Number four, the degree, quality, nature, and extent of one's interest in land or other property. So it's a person's property. So what was Eve's estate? What was her realm of authority? All right, let's read Genesis 2:18. "And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an helpmeet for him." All right, so here we see the purpose of Eve. Her purpose is to be a helpmeet for Adam. So let's look at the word helpmeet. Okay, I want to emphasize that the word helpmeet or the position of helpmeet is not a derogatory term. So let's look at the use of the word helpmeet in the Bible. All right, so first of all, we see where it is used in speaking of Eve. "And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an helpmeet," which is Hebrews 5:8-8, "for him." All right, then we see that this same word is used of God in a number of verses, but we'll look at Psalm 33:20. It says, "Our soul waiteth for the Lord. He is our help," the exact same word, "and our shield." And if we look at Deuteronomy 33:7, Psalm 75, and Psalm 159:9-11, among others, we see the same word used to describe God himself. Then in Hebrews, the New Testament, We also see God described as a helper, which is G998. And then in the New Testament, we also see it speak of the Holy Spirit in Romans 8:26. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth, G4878, our infirmities, and maketh intercession for us with groaning which cannot be uttered. All right, so a helpmeet or a helper is not a derogatory term. So the role of helpmeet or helper comes with great power. And the power of a woman can be a great force either for God's purposes or for Satan's. And Satan knew this. So right at the beginning, he manipulated Eve in order to cause Adam to sin. We also see the same kind of effect of a woman on a man with Delilah. And she brought Samson down, and Jezebel, who was the wife of one of Israel's most evil kings. But then we also see some women who were extremely powerful for God. Esther, who submitted herself to her king fully and saved her people, the entire nation of Israel. If you'd like to learn to see what I've learned from the book of Esther concerning what I learned from the book of Esther as to what God would have us be like as queens, you could, the video Prepare Yourself is where I share that. We can look at Deborah, who was a servant of God, and Mary, who was so submissive that when the angel came to her, even though she didn't understand, she said, let it be, you know, as the Lord desires. So when we are in our proper place, we can be an incredibly important force for good. So let's take a look at how Eve got deceived. We read in the book of Enoch concerning the fallen angels. The Lord said, you have been in heaven, but all the mysteries had not yet been revealed to you, and you knew the worthless ones. And these, in the hardness of your hearts, you have made known to the women, and through these mysteries women and men work much evil on earth. Say to them, therefore, you have no peace. Do you not find it interesting that the angels initially made these mysteries known to the women? And it was the women who then affected the men, and they worked much evil on the earth. The word witchcraft, a witch is specifically a woman. Okay. So these worthless mysteries that the angels knew, this is sorcery, witchcraft, the arts of war, destructive things. And this is what they have used to deceive and control mankind. So let's look at the interaction between the serpent and Eve in the garden. So we're looking at Genesis 3, starting at verse 1. So it says, the serpent was more subtle. So that's H6175. Let's look at that. H6175. Subtle, shrewd, crafty. It's usually used in a bad sense. It can, sly, yeah. It can mean sensible, but that's not its normal use, and obviously that's not its use here in Genesis. All right, so he was more subtle, And I'm just abbreviating this. It says than any of the beasts of the field. He said, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Isn't it interesting how he puts the emphasis on not, and that there's something that's been denied them? Although every other tree in the garden, God said, go ahead and eat from them. All right. So then in verse 2, Eve says, yes, we may eat. Verse 3, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. So right here, he's calling God a liar. Verse 5, for God doth know that in the day ye eat of it, thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Well, this is another lie. Eve was already as God. Adam and Eve were created in the image of God. Verse 6, and when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. All right, let's look at a few things here. All right, she began, and this was her temptation, to choose her own understanding over obedience to God. So this is elevating the carnal mind above obedience to God's commandments. Plus, she did not submit this idea to Adam. She was created as Adam's helpmeet. She did not have the authority to initiate this action. Somehow, she has come out of her position, her first estate, and she is initiating an action that she does not have authority to initiate. Okay, she should have discussed this idea with Adam, submitted it to him, and it would have been his responsibility to take it to the Lord or make his decision. But she did not have that authority, so she stepped out from under his protective covering. She was a helpmeet, not an initiator. She was there to help Adam fulfill God's commandment, not break it. And we see here, talking about wisdom, okay? She wanted wisdom. Our Bible tells us that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All right. She was out of order. Okay. We see in 1 Corinthians 11:7b that man is the image and glory of God, but woman is the glory of man. For man is not from woman, but woman from man. Nor was man created for the woman, but woman for the man. And we do see here women are more emotional, more easily manipulated by the enemy. So we always emphasize Eve's, that she was deceived. But I believe what the Lord is showing me right now is that her first mistake was to step out of her divinely appointed place of ministry. So let us not let Satan lie to us any longer. Women were deceived into going into the workforce. And I experienced that pressure myself when my first child was only a few months old. It came from the atmosphere, and I just had this strong sense that I needed to go out and do something worthwhile with my life. It was essentially saying that taking care of my child was not worthwhile. And I was ready to follow that belief, which wasn't even my own. Like I said, it came from the atmosphere. But I had decided that I wanted to be home with my children, so I began to be in a battle. Lord, you know, I had decided I wanted to stay home with my children, and now I feel like I need to go out and do something worthwhile with my life. What is going on? And I cried out to God, and it took 2 weeks before he broke through, and all he said was, I want you to make this house a home and fill it with love. And immediately, the prince of the power of the air lost his power over me. It was utterly broken. Our Bible tells us that the Spirit will lead us into all truth, and the truth will set us free. So the truth is, we have an important role to play as helpmates to our husbands, but also we are the bride of Christ. So we are Jesus's helpmates. This is a high calling. All right. So look at women now. They've been seduced to go into the workforce. And at first, you know, they could buy extra things. They had some freedom, or what they perceived as freedom. But look at women now. You know, they're not doing great. They're torn apart. Their hearts really, for the most part, want to be at home with their children, taking care and nurturing their husbands and children. And they have to go to work. And so they put their children in daycares. And oh my goodness, you know, this is not the freedom that we were looking for. So do not let the enemy steal your joy, your true beauty, your source of fulfillment, and your destiny. They're all found in your God-given role and place of authority as a helpmeet in his service. So as Christians, first and foremost, we are Jesus's helpmeets. And as wives, we are our husband's helpmeets, especially if our husbands are true Christian men serving the Lord. And even if they're not, we're to be submitted to them unless the Lord himself directs us otherwise. And who knows that an unbeliever might not be saved. We read that in our Bible by his wife's, you know, respectful attitude and, you know, the fruits of the Spirit that she displays. He may be saved through that. So now, on the rare occasion, the Lord has himself directed me to do other than what my husband asked. But that is a very rare occurrence, and it was very, very clear, and for a very short time. And we saw the fruits of that, and they were good. So, okay. Let's take a quick look at the Proverbs 31 woman. It's entitled, The Wife of Noble Character. A wife of noble character, who can find? She is worth far more than rubies. Her husband has full confidence in her and lacks nothing of value. She brings him good, not harm, all the days of her life. And then it goes on to describe, you know, that she's industrious and takes care of her family, she nurtures, but she does more than that. She has a small business, and some of us women, you know, find this a bit intimidating. But she, because she was in her proper estate, she had the power of God flowing through her and causing her to have the strength to do many, many good works. All right, I'm going to skip to another section here just a second. All right, here we are. She provides food for her family and portions for her servant girls. So she's focused on her family and running the household. We'll skip down here. She opens her arms to the poor and extends her hands to the needy. When it snows, she has no fear for her household, for all of them are clothed in scarlet. She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. She watches over the affairs of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children arise and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many women do noble things, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceptive, and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her the reward she has earned, and let her works bring her praise at the city gate. All right, this is something my dear husband repeatedly asked me to emphasize. This is our own experience. As the Lord has led me to submit more and more fully to my husband, as my husband said, you know, initially his thought was, oh, wow, you know, my wife will do anything I want. And you know, he said, like, it's a natural kind of thought that, you know, you'll have more control and stuff. But he said, it is actually the opposite. As I've submitted more and more fully, it was a spiritual effect that he felt the weight of his responsibility and accountability much more. So as I submitted more fully, he became more and more aware of his accountability before God in how he treats me. And so it has been a good thing for both of us. He is being elevated to a higher authority, but also a higher accountability and a greater sense of responsibility. And he's been much more careful with the things he says and the things he does. And the Lord has given him grace to rise up to become more and more the man that God created him to be. So that's just what I wanted to share concerning that. So in conclusion, I want to talk about what I believe is one of God's end time purposes for women. Okay. As Satan deceived Eve and she fell from her first estate, her proper position in authority, she was open to deception. But as women now, we have the opportunity to reverse that and to choose to embrace the divine purpose we were created for and become all we were created to be. And in doing that, I believe we will have an effect that we may not have realized, that we as women can have the ability to destroy the power of witchcraft and even to destroy the witch king himself, as was portrayed in the video from Lord of the Rings. So I would just like to play you a couple of videos that touched my heart and relate to this purpose of a woman. And yes, hopefully they'll speak to your heart as well. Here we go. So this is a clip, and I'm sorry the quality of the video is not great, but this is a clip from the movie Stardust. And in this scene, this is a witch here who is trying to destroy this young woman and her husband, who is destined to become a king. And she's sure now that she is going to be able to destroy them. So let's see what happens.
Thanks, boy. What use was a heart to me when it was broke? And you got rid of my sister. Now I can have it all for myself. Hold it tight and close your eyes.
What? Why?
What do you stars do? And shine with a broken heart. I thought I'd lost you. But you came back.
Of course I did. I love you.
So before we move on to the next clip, I just wanted to share that anything to do with shining has always caught my eye. I know I've shared before, but I'll share it quickly, that a prayer came up from my spirit and out of my mouth without me hearing. And without me thinking of it prior. And that prayer was, oh God, I want to shine. I want to be something where people go, wow, what has she got? And so when I see a woman shine, that reminds me of that prayer. And the Lord did not rebuke me for that. That came straight from my spirit. And instead, what he said was, wait for the unveiling. So there's a power and a shining to be released in the unveiling. And a woman in her right estate, in her right place of authority, will be able to do mighty, mighty exploits on behalf of the kingdom. All right, so let us take one look at this last clip. This is from Lord of the Rings, and the scene where the Witch King is destroyed.
Thank you.
Okay, I would like to leave you with this verse, the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" He called a little child and had him stand among them. And he said, "I tell you the truth. Unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." Women, I believe this is our high calling, to humble ourselves and to embrace the role that God has given us and to exercise our authority in that role and watch what He does through us. God bless you and keep you. And I will talk to you soon. Love you lots. Bye-bye.